It's great to see you all this morning. I'm so glad that you were able to gather here with us at Autumn Ridge Church today. If we have not had a chance to meet, my name is Rick. I have the privilege of being one of the pastors here. And for anyone who's new or newish to our church, I want to invite you to something called Let's Connect. We just love to get to know you. And it would mean a lot to me if I'd had the opportunity to answer the questions that are most pressing to you. As people are checking out a church, how do you know if this is the right church for you? And we would love to be a church home, a church family for you. And we think coming to this event, Let's Connect, we'll provide lunch and we'll get a chance to get to know each other, could be really, really helpful. And the way to engage is just look at the QR code on the armrest where you're at. Just scan that and it'll give you the information you need. And you can also register, and I hope to see you there. Now, for others of you, maybe you've been around for a little while, I hope that you've gotten connected with a group of friends. That's a big deal. I hope you got connected with a small group. Tomorrow night, my wife and I, we're hosting a barbecue for our small group. We love to lead it. And if you have ever thought about that, well, what would be involved? I want to invite you to stop by a table out in the lobby, meet Pastor Svea, get a little information, just talking to her. You're not making a commitment, but I'd love for you to have the opportunity to get a little information about what it might mean to host and lead a small group in your home. So check that out. Today we're continuing in our second week of a series on the Holy Spirit. I want to ask you to grab a Bible, pull it out, and turn to the book of John, chapter 14. If you're still kind of getting familiar with how the Bible is laid out, it's really broken up into two parts. The first and bigger part is the Old Testament. That's everything before Jesus. The second part is called the New Testament. That's everything from Jesus forward. And John is the fourth book, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and then John. So kind of open that up, hold it, keep it there. We'll come back to that in a few minutes. As you're turning there, I'm curious if anybody recognizes this guy. This is Nick Cave. He's the front man of the band Nick Cave and the Bad Seeds. And there's a interview that's floating around online that he recently did with Stephen Colbert. And in this interview, he read two different letters. The first letter that he read, a fan wrote to him. It was a young man. He was despairing. He was empty. He was hopeless. He was really battling cynicism. And this young man was afraid he was going to pass it on to his little son. And if you're wondering, well, why write to a rock star, you know? If you don't know Nick Cave, that's a question that you might be asking. But this guy right here is no stranger to profound grief himself. Nick Cave has lost two sons. And some of us in this room, you know what it's like just to be shredded by sorrow and loss. Some of us know what it is to have our sense of hope just left in tatters. And some of us know all too well what it is to kind of hold on to a single thread, hoping that it won't break, but you're certain it will. And maybe I'm describing what it's like to be you right now. Well, the second letter that Nick Cave wrote was his letter of response to that young man. And as he read what he wrote, I was on the edge of my seat because it was vulnerable, it was raw, it was real, and it was full of rugged truth. And I want to encourage you to find some time, go look it up, watch the whole interview yourself. But there was something that he said that really grabbed a hold of me, and I want to share it with you. Talking about hope, he said, hope is the warrior emotion that can lay waste to cynicism. Can we talk about hope for a few minutes? Hope is a prescription with no expiration date. And we all desperately need hope because without it, we're going to be just filled and left with cynicism. And cynicism is that thing that causes us sometimes to assume the worst about other people. Cynicism is that thing that causes us to doubt that all the good that we contribute will ever make a difference. Cynicism is that thing that causes people to sometimes conclude, even if God exists, he's ghosted us and left us alone in this mess. And believe it or not, even devout church people can be in the grip of cynicism too. Did you know that? Since we're in a political season, I want to look at it from a political viewpoint. What is it that causes followers of Jesus to say, you know what, things like love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, gentleness, faithfulness, it's not working anymore. And when those things stop working, we need to find leaders who will abandon them and we'll elect people who are as nasty and as mean as they need to be to get the job done. Well, that is cynicism through and through. And by the way, that list of virtues that I just rattled off, love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, gentleness, faithfulness, self-control, has a name to that. What is that list? The fruit of the Spirit. Those are Jesus-like qualities that he cultivates and produces in all people with whom and in whom he lives. If I could go back, I'd love to meet Nick Cave. If we could share a cup of coffee together, I would want to talk to him about what is the substance of hope. And he's right, there's an emotion that comes with it. There's powerful feelings that come with it. But you know this, and I know this, and he knows this, that hope cannot be reduced to a feeling alone. So what is it? What is the gritty substance of hope? I want you to write down two things. The first is this. Hope is knowing that you're not alone. It's knowing that you are not alone. And so in some sense, hope has something to do with who you're with and who is with you. And let me tell you something that followers of Jesus know, that there is an ultimate hope. And the ultimate hope is knowing that God is with you. This is why you will read lines like this in the Bible. Faith is the substance of things hoped for. It's not wishing and wanting and pretending. Faith is trust. It's allegiance, saying, Jesus, I am following. I trust in you. And that comes with a very real, rugged, relational bond that brings hope to us because we know that God really is with us. That's how Jesus, he looked his followers right in the eye, his crew, his closest group of guys, and he says, I'm not going to be here physically with you anymore. I'm going, you can't come with me. And in that, he was offering to them and also offering to us hope. He said, it's good. It's actually better that way. Let's look at a verse we saw last week. Jesus said, very truly, I tell you, it is for your good that I'm going away. Unless I go away, the advocate will not come to you. But if I go, I will send him to you. And who is the advocate? It's the Holy Spirit. That's God. He is the third person of the Trinity. God is one in being. And three in persons. And if you missed last week, give yourself the gift of returning to that message because we dig into the Trinity and how God is one in being and three in persons. But today I want to zoom in on this. What do you think it was like? What happened? Those guys who were there with Jesus, they heard Jesus say this. What was it like when the penny finally dropped and they understood what Jesus meant? They were good Jewish boys. Their minds would have been filled with Old Testament references and stories that included the Holy Spirit. They would have remembered that it was the Holy Spirit of God who was hovering over the surface of the chaotic waters even before God really got going with the creation process. They would have remembered all those times that Old Testament heroes, the Holy Spirit came to be with them, empowering them to serve God and protect people. How he was with David when he slayed Goliath. And they would have thought about things, remembered things that they saw with their own eyes. How when Jesus was baptized, that the Holy Spirit of God descended on him like a dove, and they heard a voice from heaven say, this is my son, and I'm so pleased with him. The Holy Spirit coming to us may be the most profound experience we will ever know because he, the Holy Spirit, is the certainty that God is with us. And so with that in view, I think we're ready to read a portion of what Jesus had to say. So grab your Bible. We're going to look at John chapter 14. I'm going to begin in verse 25, holding it in your hands. Let's see it. Let's hear it. Some of what Jesus had to say. He said, all of this I've spoken to you while with you, but the advocate, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, he's going to teach you all things. I remind you of everything I've said to you. Truth is incredibly important. The Holy Spirit is the Spirit of truth. And he brings and reminds us of truth that we need to know. But this life with Jesus cannot be reduced to information and truth and facts about who God is and what the Christian life is like. Experience is also included. That's why Jesus said, peace I leave with you. My peace I give you. I do not give as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled. And do not be afraid. The Holy Spirit, he is the certainty that God is with us. And that gives us a hope. And a hope that produces a rock solid, unbreakable peace. And this is why we are saying in this series, it's our constant drumbeat. We're repeating it. We're going to say it every week. The Holy Spirit in you is better than Jesus with you. The Holy Spirit in you is better than Jesus with you. And last night in our Q&A on Saturday night, somebody asked me, well, again, why did Jesus have to go? Because if Jesus were here physically, the best we could ever hope for is to be in the crowd, never up close. Because if Jesus were here, he would be limited to time and space. He'd be physically here. And so even if he were in an arena, there's no guarantee that any of us would even get a seat in the arena. We'd have to stream him on Netflix or something. The closest we could ever hope to is to be in the crowd, not up close. But because of the Holy Spirit, the certainty that God is with us, he makes possible for us to know and be with Jesus in a profound, intimate, true way. This is a huge deal. The Holy Spirit in you is better than Jesus with you. And so this week, I got an email from a guy. Last week, he was listening to the sermon keenly and thinking sharply, and he sent in a question, and part of his question included a reference to something that Jesus said earlier. He referenced something that Jesus said just a few sentences earlier, so jump up to John 14, verse 17. Jesus refers to the Holy Spirit as the Spirit of truth, and then he says, the world cannot accept him. The world cannot accept the Holy Spirit because it neither sees him or knows him. It can't accept him because it doesn't know him, but you know him, for he lives in you and will be in you. And so the question that this guy asked me, this isn't verbatim, but this is essentially the question. If you need the Holy Spirit to understand, but he only comes to be in those who understand, how does anyone ever get the Holy Spirit? That's not a clown question. That is a good and a thick question. And it's just going to, and this is a good thing, it takes time. It's a process to come to a place where we can really understand all that Jesus wants us to know about who the Holy Spirit is and what a gift he is to us. I want to strongly encourage you, carve out time, read John 14, 15, and 16. Read it over several times. Think about it. Make observations. Let's do a portion of that together. In John 16, we'll start with a verse we're familiar with, John 16, 7. Jesus said, but truly, very truly, I tell you, it's for your good that I'm going away. Unless I go away, the advocate will not come to you. But if I go, I will send him to you. So what does he do? What does he do when he's with us? When he comes, he will prove the world to be in the wrong about sin, righteousness, and judgment. He's going to be working to show us we need some truth, and we are wrong about some really important things. About sin, because people do not believe in me, about righteousness, because I'm going to the Father where you can see me no longer, and about judgment, because of the prince of this world now stands condemned. What is Jesus saying? This is the Holy Spirit is personally involved with you and with me, bringing us to a point where we can get honest about our own sin. Now, before anybody's defenses go up, give me 30 seconds. How many of us have this experience in our life? You know what the right thing is to do, and you on purpose say, I ain't doing that. Anybody else? All right. Some of my people are here. On the flip side, how many of us have had those moments in life? We know what the wrong thing is. And on purpose, we're like, yep, I'm doing that. I got lots of moments like that in my life. I'm not really interested in the nuts and bolts and the details of those behaviors. I'm more interested in what is that deep down thing in you and that deep down thing in me that causes us to do that. The Holy Spirit loves the world so much that he is personally coming alongside of you and coming alongside of me and helping us get honest about stuff in us that we'd rather not admit. So that we can see the truth about righteousness and we're not the authorities on it and it doesn't begin with us. Helping us to come to terms with the truth of our own moral brokenness and the consequences that come with that. Helping us to come to terms with what happens if we are never reconciled to the God who loves us and made us in his image. And all of this, he's doing all of this so that we will behold the truth, goodness, and beauty of Jesus so that we will trust in him. So what's the answer to this question? There is lots that we could say, but I think we can embrace this summary statement. Even before you accept him, the Holy Spirit, even before you accept him, he is wooing you to accept Jesus so that you can then accept him. Even before you believe in and trust in Jesus, he is wooing you to trust and believe in Jesus so that you can then receive him. And the question is, well, how does that work? How does he do that? To have any hope of understanding how that might work, it's probably to our benefit to understand how it is that we make decisions. How is it that we come to believe things? How is it that we make judgments about all kinds of things? And what I want to share with you is something that I've found incredibly helpful. And if you want to know the research and the science behind what some of the things I'm going to share, you might want to familiarize yourself with Jonathan Haidt, read his book, The Righteous Mind. That's not a religious book. He's an agnostic, but his insights and his research is incredibly helpful. I want to show you a picture of something and see if you can guess who this is. Do you guys recognize that person? It's not Frosty the Snowman. This is you. And this is me. And this is all people. And included in who we are, we have two things. We have a reasoning framework, and we have an intuitive framework. This is our system of using our intuitions. And hey, hang with me, right? This is not a TED Talk. You're still in church. Our reasoning framework, this is your God-given ability to competently process information and to understand reality and facts and truth. Our reasoning framework is our God-given ability to be able to process facts and data and anecdotes and arguments and all of that. This is the God-given part of you that makes you a competent scientist, that makes you a competent geography teacher, that makes you a competent mechanic, that makes you able to be a competent farmer, right? We all have this reasoning framework, but this is not all there is to us. We also have an intuitive framework. And if our reasoning framework is how we put facts and information together, our intuitive framework is about how we're put together. And it's not the same for any two people, because your intuitive framework is formed by your personality and temperament, your family of origin, your culture, your life experiences, your tribe and trusted voices, your sense of identity and your insecurities, your presuppositions. And your presuppositions, those are the deep down beliefs that we all have. Those are the things that we believe that this is how the world works, right? Now, here's the kicker. Everybody likes to think of themselves as I make judgments and I come to beliefs based on my reasoning framework. But all the data and science shows us that we naturally actually make judgments and decisions and beliefs here with our intuitive framework. But then we use our reasoning, our God-given reasoning framework, to justify and defend everything we came to intuitively. And if you're thinking, no, I don't believe that, I think that's wrong. Well, that's okay. You're allowed to disagree with me. I've said this before. I've raised three teenagers. I'm used to being disagreed with. It's okay. But if you do disagree, let me ask you this question. Do you disagree because you've sifted through the research and you've reasoned your way through all the data and science? Are you just intuitively like, I don't think that's right, therefore proving the point? Now, here's someone we got to recognize. Just because you're using your reasoning framework doesn't mean you're right. And just because you use your intuitive framework doesn't mean you're wrong. But know this. Using this, it takes time and effort. Sometimes lots of time and lots of effort. But our intuition system, our intuitive framework, it is instant and effortless. Have you ever wondered why? How is it that people, they don't ask any questions, but they just assume they know everything? This kind of makes sense of that. How many of you guys have ever wondered, why are people so dumb? Right? What you're trying to figure out and what we're asking in a not-so-friendly way is really explained by this. Have you ever wondered, how is it that two people who are both smart have access to the exact same information and come to wildly different conclusions? This helps explain that. How many of you have somebody in your life, it's a friend or a family member, and there are things you guys cannot talk about it together? This helps explain that. Why is it that people from different political tribes and different cultural tribes, why is it they can't even agree on what the facts are? This helps explain that. How many of you guys know someone that they are so committed to a narrative that they can't even entertain or be open to facts that might contradict the narrative that they've given their loyalty to? This helps explain that. Years ago, I was a youth pastor, so I was a pastor to high school and middle school students, and at a dinner party, I met a couple who I went to church with. Their daughter was in my youth group, and so we were talking about her, and I just happened to mention, oh, we're Facebook friends, and they said, oh, you must be mistaken. She's not on Facebook. Do you parents remember, any parents remember the good old days when we believed we can keep our kids off the internet and social media? And sometimes I'm just slow on the uptake, and I'm like, no, we're friends on Facebook. And I described their daughter, and I basically proved to them that she was on Facebook. And they said, you must be mistaken. Our daughter is not on Facebook. Do you think that they insisted on their delusion because they were dumb? No way. Getting stuck in this loop is not because of the absence of intelligence. The research tells us it's just the opposite. That the more intelligent someone is, the better they are at using their God-given reasoning framework to justify their intuitions, even when their intuitions are dead wrong. Here's the sobering reality, that the smarter we are, the more likely it is that we're stuck in this loop. But I've got good news. We don't have to be slaves to that. God has given us this for a reason. We can not only evaluate information, we can rigorously evaluate and critically evaluate our own selves and our own intuitive framework and learn and grow and change our minds. This is how you get scientific breakthroughs and technological breakthroughs and personal breakthroughs and relationship breakthroughs. Did anybody bring their guts today? You guys bring your guts with you? Anybody feeling brave? You might need to borrow from somebody you're with. Let's talk about something that's going to require a little bit of bravery. How many of us, if we got honest, we would have to admit we've spent too much of our lives not just stuck in this loop, but volunteering for the slavery of it? All right. One brave dude here. Thank you. Let me ask you this. How many of you have ever been in a disagreement with somebody, and somewhere in the middle of it, you realized they were right and you were wrong, and you used all of your God-given reasoning framework to delay admitting it for as long as possible, or even wiggle out of ever admitting it? How many of you have ever used your God-given reasoning framework to present yourself as not being responsible for something when you know you were responsible? How many of you have ever used your God-given reasoning framework to, on purpose, avoid information that might contradict you? Is it just me? How many of us know what it's like to automatically feel warm and connect with people who agree with us, and not just feel suspicious of people who have a different point of view, but find every reason in the book why we don't have to listen to them? Since that has nothing to do with an absence of intelligence, what's left? What is that about? What is the best word to describe us when we will not acknowledge reality? There's probably a lot of good words, but maybe the best word is proud. When it's not an absence of intelligence, what are we talking about? We're talking about character. And if our character will not allow us to admit that we're wrong or to be open to another view, we are talking about something that is morally broken inside of us. And it is pride that stiffens our neck. And it is pride that closes our eyes to truth, even truth about ourselves. There's a man who knew this firsthand. He did it over and over. He lived in this loop. But Jesus was gracious to him and was kind to him and forgiving to him and changed his life. And he is a guy who knew Jesus up close and personal. He was in his inner circle. The guy that I'm talking about is a man named Peter. Now, this is what Peter wrote down for us to know. He said, God opposes the proud, but shows favor to the humble. It takes humility to say, I could be wrong. It takes humility to say that I am wrong. And I'm not just wrong about some stuff. You know what? I get the biggest stuff wrong. And sometimes I want to live like and pretend like goodness begins with me and I'm kind of the authority, and I'm wrong. Did you know that it's not my long list of morally broken choices that I have regret over that ultimately keeps me from being with God? And it's not your long list of morally broken choices that you have regret about that ultimately keeps you from being with God. Those aren't the things. that keep us from turning to Jesus in repentance. Those are not the things. Our regrets are not the things that keep us from turning to Jesus in repentance and discovering his kindness and his grace and his love and his forgiveness and his acceptance. You know what it is? It is our pride that keeps us from doing that. I want to return to our answer. What is it that the Holy Spirit is doing? Even before you accept him, he is wooing you to accept Jesus so that you can then accept him. This is how gracious and kind he is. He is personally engaged in your life, working in your life and the circumstances in your life, and he is personally engaged in my life and working in the circumstances in my life to bring us to a point where we can be humble and acknowledge the truth and turn to it. Did you know that you are that loved? How do you respond to a love like that? Where we're in the wrong, we stay stuck in this loop, and we're prideful and we're arrogant, and instead of crushing us and instead of condemning us, that God comes alongside us and woos us into humility to where we can be honest about the truth and our need for Jesus. Where we could see that on the cross that he died and his blood covers our sin. And in exchange, we get his life. And he rose from the dead, proving that he is who he said he was, and his promise is true. How is it that the Holy Spirit brings us to the point that we understand that? It could look different for every single one of us. I don't exactly know how it all works, but I do know this, that he is going to give you what you need to come to that point. Will we respond? I've got friends who would say it was a health scare, it was adversity, it was pain in my life, and the Holy Spirit used that to get my attention to see the truth so that I could turn to it. I've got friends who were raised in a very, very different religion, and for them it was a dream in which they were just told in this dream, go talk to this person because they're going to tell you about Jesus. And that's what the Holy Spirit used to get their attention, to show them the truth so that they could turn to it. I've got friends who would say it was in rehab, it was in a jail cell, it was when I hit rock bottom. That's what the Holy Spirit used to grab my attention, to point me to the truth so that I could turn to it. And then I've got other friends who would say it wasn't hitting rock bottom, it was being at the mountaintop. I hit success in all the ways that I've defined success. I achieved every goal that I set out for myself, and I discovered it did not fulfill me. And the Holy Spirit used that to grab my attention, to show me the truth so that I could turn to it. I don't know what it is for you. I've got friends who would say, I could look back over decades of my life and I see that God was faithful. The Holy Spirit was working, wooing me to himself. And all that time, my mom was praying for me and he got my attention so that I could see the truth and turn to it. And maybe for you, it is people that he has brought in your life right now, and you are looking at their life and you are seeing the truthfulness and the trustworthy of Jesus. And maybe in a few moments, as we celebrate those who are being baptized, and you see what God has done in their life, that it is going to be undeniable to you. And the question is, when God loves you this much, when the Spirit of God comes alongside you and he is that personally invested in you, wooing you to the truth, goodness, and beauty of Jesus, how do you respond? For some of us in this room, you might be ready to say, I get it, the light has come on. And I got the receipts to prove it. I know that I'm morally broken. I'm a sinner, and I'm ready to pray, Jesus, I'm a sinner, and I need a Savior. I believe in who you are, that you died on the cross for my sins, and you rose from the dead. I give my life to you. Would you give your life to me? In just a few moments, I'm going to pray, and that might be a prayer that you're ready to pray. We would invite you to trust in Jesus. And then there might be others of us. Maybe you are not ready to follow Jesus, or maybe you've been following Jesus for a long, long time, and our prayer might be the exact same. Dear God, if I am stuck in this loop and there are true things that I am not seeing, my pride is keeping me from seeing the truth, would you bring me to a place of humility where I can see the truth and turn to it? Dear God, by your Holy Spirit, would you bring me to a place of humility where I could see the truth and turn to it? I want to pray right now, and I want to invite you to pray right where you are in whatever way you believe is best. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your love and your grace and your kindness, God. We thank you for the certainty that you are with us through the presence of the Holy Spirit. And God, I want to pray for those people in the room right now that you have brought them to a place that they can see the truth, goodness, and beauty of Jesus, and they are ready to repent. And God, I want to pray for any man or woman or child in this room who's ready to say, Jesus, I know that I'm a sinner. I believe in you. I believe you died on the cross and rose from the dead. I give my life to you. Would you accept me? And God, for the rest of us in this room, God, it is my prayer that we would just turn to you with enough humility to say, would you give us, would you bring us to a place of humility to see if we are stuck in our pride, if we're not seeing the truth, that we could see it and turn to it. God, you are so gentle and kind and gracious to us. We are grateful. And we pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen.